Hi, my name is Dr. Lee-Shing Chang, and I'm an associate physician and endocrinologist at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston, Massachusetts. In this video, we'll talk about SGLT2 inhibitors and their use in CKD, or chronic kidney disease. Key takeaways from this video are to understand the key findings of the landmark kidney outcomes trials for SGLT2 inhibitors, which are the CREDENCE and the DAPA-CKD trials, and to understand basic proposed mechanisms for kidney protection with SGLT2 inhibitors. SGLT2 inhibitors are emerging as key kidney protective therapies in CKD. How did they become established as not only glucose-lowering medications, but kidney protective medications? They were initially designed as medications for use in diabetes because their main mechanism of action is inducing glucosuria by inhibiting the sodium glucose cotransporter 2 pump located in the proximal nephron. This pump helps to reabsorb filtered glucose. The FDA mandated in 2008 that all new type 2 diabetes medications had to prove cardiovascular safety. The results of the first major cardiovascular outcomes trials with SGLT2 inhibitors was EMPA-REG OUTCOME, which was published in 2015. Not only did it show cardiovascular safety, but it also showed a significant reduction in worsening nephropathy. This was also seen in subsequent cardiovascular outcomes trials, including CANVAS program for canagliflozin and the DECLARE-TIMI-58 trial for dapagliflozin. Two kidney outcomes trials for SGLT2 inhibitors have been completed thus far, CREDENCE for canagliflozin and DAPA-CKD for dapagliflozin. We'll dive into both trials in more detail, but I wanted to start with an overview. Both trials were done in patients with nephropathy, including albuminuria. UACR here stands for urine albumin to creatinine ratio, which is a measure of albuminuria. Interestingly, both trials were stopped early for efficacy. These trials have marked a major therapeutic advance in nephrology. We'll go into both trials in more detail. CREDENCE was the first randomized controlled trial of an SGLT2 inhibitor that was specifically powered for primary kidney outcomes among patients with albuminuric CKD. CREDENCE studied 4,401 patients with type 2 diabetes and albuminuric CKD with an eGFR between 30 and 90 and albuminuria between 300 and 5,000 milligrams per gram of creatinine. These patients were treated with renin-angiotensin system blockade at baseline. Participants were randomized to receive either canagliflozin 100 milligrams daily or placebo. The primary outcome was a composite of end-stage kidney disease, doubling of serum creatinine level from baseline, and death from renal or cardiovascular disease. The trial was stopped early after a planned interim analysis on the recommendation of the Data and Safety Monitoring Committee due to meeting pre-specified efficacy for early cessation. It showed a 30% reduction in the primary composite outcome after a median follow-up of 2.6 years. The kidney-specific outcome was basically similar to the primary composite outcome, except focused on renal death, not renal death and cardiovascular death. The kidney-specific outcome showed a 34% risk reduction. Additionally, patients treated with canagliflozin had lower rates of 3-point major adverse cardiovascular events and hospitalization for heart failure. DAPA-CKD studied 4,304 patients with albuminuric CKD with an eGFR between 25 and 75 and albuminuria between 200 and 5,000 milligrams per gram of creatinine. Patients had to be treated with renin-angiotensin system blockade or be intolerant of ACE inhibitors or ARBs. In contrast to CREDENCE, where all patients had type 2 diabetes, in DAPA-CKD, patients with and without type 2 diabetes were included. About one-third of participants did not have type 2 diabetes. Participants were randomized to receive either dapagliflozin 10 milligrams daily or placebo. The primary composite outcome in DAPA-CKD, assessed in a time-to-event analysis, was the first occurrence of any of the following: a sustained decline of at least 50% in eGFR, the onset of end-stage kidney disease, or death from renal or cardiovascular causes. The trial was stopped early, similar to CREDENCE, after a planned interim analysis on the recommendation of the Independent Data Monitoring Committee due to efficacy. It showed a 39% reduction in the primary composite outcome after a median follow-up of 2.4 years. Importantly, DAPA-CKD showed that the reduction in the primary outcome was significant regardless of baseline type 2 diabetes, indicating that the kidney protective effects of SGLT2 inhibitors extend beyond simply patients with type 2 diabetes, but likely to the wider spectrum of patients with CKD with or without diabetes. The kidney-specific outcome in DAPA-CKD was basically similar to the primary composite outcome, except it was focused on renal death, not renal death or cardiovascular death. And the kidney-specific outcome showed a 44% risk reduction. Additional secondary outcomes showed significant reductions in a composite of cardiovascular death or hospitalization for heart failure by 29%, and a significant reduction in all-cause mortality by 31%. Guidelines in CKD and type 2 diabetes have already been updated to include these groundbreaking trials. KDIGO, or Kidney Disease Improving Global Outcomes, published a clinical practice guideline in 2020 for diabetes management in CKD, which recommends SGLT2 inhibitors in patients with CKD with eGFR of at least 30, prioritizing agents with documented kidney or cardiovascular benefits. Note that the KDIGO guidelines were published in 2020, before the full data from DAPA-CKD were published. The ADA, or American Diabetes Association, publishes standards of care each year. The 2022 ADA Standards of Care recommends that in patients with type 2 diabetes and albuminuria, that an SGLT2 inhibitor with primary evidence of reducing CKD progression be used in patients with type 2 diabetes and albuminuria of at least 200 milligrams per gram of creatinine, and that an SGLT2 inhibitor or a GLP-1 receptor agonist with proven CV disease benefit be used in patients with type 2 diabetes who have an eGFR less than 60 without albuminuria. How do SGLT2 inhibitors provide kidney benefits? This is a very hot topic in the subject of ongoing research. There are likely numerous mechanisms for this kidney protection benefit. By blocking SGLT2 in the nephron, SGLT2 inhibitors reduce not only glucose reabsorption, but sodium reabsorption. This causes glucosuria and natriuresis. This reduces intravascular volume and blood pressure. Moreover, increased delivery of sodium to the distal nephron and macula densa helps to normalize tubuloglomerular feedback and reduce intraglomerular pressure and glomerular hyperfiltration. These are just a few of the proposed mechanisms of kidney protection with SGLT2 inhibitors. The role of SGLT2 inhibitors as kidney protective tools remains an exciting topic of research, and we'll end by highlighting a few future directions in this field. We looked at the kidney outcomes trials for canagliflozin and dapagliflozin, which have already been completed. Again, those are CREDENCE and DAPA-CKD. EMPA-KIDNEY is a kidney outcomes trial studying empagliflozin in both diabetic and non-diabetic kidney disease. Study completion is expected in late 2022. Finally, it's important to note that potential SGLT2 inhibitor benefits are not yet clear in several key groups of individuals with kidney disease. This includes individuals with a low eGFR, particularly in the range below 25, individuals who have received a kidney transplant, and individuals with polycystic kidney disease, lupus nephropathy, and ANCA-related nephropathy. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you found this topic helpful.